Hey crew, I've got the key to that 22 Cadillac Escalade Premium Luxury. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. The Escalade got a new generation for 21, so exterior changes for 22 are pretty much non-existent. All Escalades get this massive grille, but there are three different insert options. I prefer the Sport Grade's blacked out look. There are LED headlights and daytime running lights, a little Cadillac signature there. These vertical LED light blades for your daytime running lights. This one is painted in mahogany metallic. Said another way, it's brown. But you get close and you got that metallic flake and a little reddish undertone. I like the color. I don't know if I'd be bold enough to choose it for myself, but respect to those who do go this way. Brown SUVs, you just don't see many of them. In profile, all Escalades ride on 22-inch wheels. These are not my favorite of the available designs. A little polished chromey. They're wrapped in Bridgestone all-season tires, 275 section front and rear. You have a fixed running board. It does not deploy. That's an option. Body color matching door mirrors, integrated turn signals, some polished chrome on the tops of the door handles, polished chrome for the roof rails, and bright chrome for that C-pillar accent. Stepping back to look at the profile, this thing is huge, and the wheelbase was extended 4.9 inches for this new generation Escalade. As we make the long journey to the back, we're going to find a pair of LED light bars, kind of matching that vertical blade design of the daytime running lights. Get your Cadillac Chevron logo there amidst a spanning bright chrome piece. Escalade 600D badging. The D stands for diesel. We have that engine. Two chrome exhaust finishers. And then that cap is on the trailer hitch. We can tow 7,800 pounds with the four-wheel drive version of the Escalade diesel that we have here. All in all, the design is big. This is like the rolling embodiment of the American success story. And though I choose one of the sport grades, I still appreciate the fanfare. Let's look at the interior. Opening up and looking inside at this parchment on black interior combination with perforated Moulin leather seats for the first and second rows, but then leatherette for the third row. Heating for these two captain's chairs. Stitched leatherette up here on the door panel. Gloss wood trim insert. Leather here for the armrest. Sparkly black insert there. One touch up down windows. And then an AKG 19 speaker sound system on premium luxury. One warning about getting a color this light. The floor mats get dirty so easily. You'll be cleaning them very often. To get into the third row, you could easily, of course, walk through the aisle between the captain's chairs or pull this tab once to fold it down and again to pop it up and very far away. You've got a grab handle to make walking back a breeze. And sitting behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, paralleled with the passenger side and then where I'd be comfortable in the second row. Look at that knee room. That's great for a three row SUV. Good foot pocket to slide my feet under. And then of course the alley of the captain's chairs. I do have headroom as well. And back here, I've got a cup holder, a little storage cubby, padded armrest, and a USB-C port. Now to get out, I press this button to fold down this seat and then pull this tab to lift it up and away. Here's your look at the second row in that same seating position. I've got enough knee room, foot pocket room, and thigh support. If I didn't have someone behind me, I pull this bar and really stretch out. There's always headroom as well. Third zone of climate in premium luxury. Press this and two cup holders deploy. Two USB-C ports and an AC outlet are there. Let's check out the front. The door closes with an assuring thud. Up front, we find heated and ventilated chairs with power adjustments, four-way lumbar, and speakers integrated within the headrests. There's a standard panoramic glass roof, four one-touch windows, power folding and power adjusting door mirrors. To deploy the trunk, press on that circular button there, or we go to the back to pop just this back glass if we want to for easy access. Then you can press the Cadillac logo to open up the tailgate fully. Inside we find segment leaning 26 cubic feet of space behind the third row. There's some shallow storage under the floor. You get an AC outlet there. You can press these two buttons to power fold or power raise the third row. press these two to power fold the second row. When you do that, you'll find 109 cubic feet of space. We have a power closed, but not a power closed and lock feature on the tailgate. Easy to hop up and in with that running board. And it will turn on the vehicle so we can illuminate this 38-inch across OLED display that's made up of a 7.2-inch screen here, a 14.2-inch digital gauge cluster, and then a 16.9-inch display that's responsive. The icons are easy to move around. You get wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Below the screen is gloss wood trim. Above it is injection molding with white contrast stitching. There's a head-up display and heated leather-wrapped steering wheel. This wheel is the ideal size and thickness. Driving assistance features here on the left. Media settings off to the right. Hit this button to activate the Super Cruise system when allowed, and that's what shows up on this light bar here. The center console is super wide. Ahead of it, you've got some HVAC buttons. Press down here for two cup holders and two USB ports. Kind of a cheaper feel to the gear selector and dial for your infotainment. Below the leather-topped console, we find an organizer you can remove for deeper storage. There are two USB ports. This is a wireless smartphone charging slot. Visibility is, well, out the back, it's not so great with the headrests up. Fortunately, there is a digital rearview mirror to cut through the clutter, and we have standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. It's an exclusive feeling cabin, very spacious. Let's take this diesel Escalade for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. A lot of ignition noise and then the chimes take over. Do we like the chimes? I think they're a little loud. Our 38-inch OLED is here, ready to go. And on the gauge cluster, I'm going to display that we are starting in tour drive mode. Then we'll flip up the digital rearview mirror so it's projecting, and press forward on the gear selector to go into reverse to bring up lots of camera angles, all high resolution on our 16.9-inch screen here. You've got an overhead projection. Always fun. Not as high resolution of a 3D image as those from BMW and Mercedes, though. You can also look at the front. And let's back on out of here. You didn't get trajectory lines up front. That's interesting. I don't think I've seen that much. Now, you didn't hear the Turbo 6 much upon startup beyond the ignition, but even just low speed cruising through a parking lot, it does make its way a little into the cabin. We will do our turning radius test later, but we can start with a horn test right now. Loud enough, that is for sure. Not terribly refined. Much like the truckish engine we have here. 3-liter turbo diesel inline six, 277 horsepower, 460 pound-feet of torque. For reference, that horsepower figure is down quite a bit to the standard V8 engine's 420, but the torque figure is the exact same. Now, why do I say this turbo diesel is truckish? Well, that's because turbo diesels are used in a lot of trucks, and I mean, to be fair, the Escalade is a truck. It's a body-on-frame SUV. And the reason diesels are used in trucks is because they provide tons of low-end grunt. Very important for towing and hauling because you need to get momentum quickly. And so the 460 pound-feet available in the Escalade Duramax diesel is not the same distribution of torque as you get in the V8. It's all really low down and that helps it give pretty excellent tow ratings despite having that power deficit. So it's down 200 pounds, 7,800 pounds of towing, to the V8, but you still have plenty of low-end grunt and excellent fuel economy. Just look at this. Hang on. I gotta change up our display here so we can actually be looking at augmented reality of the ocean as we're driving by the ocean. The fuel economy is great. 22 combined from 20 city and 26 highway in the four-wheel drive version. It's actually 23 combined in the rear drive version. And that's a huge step up over the 17 combined from the V8 in rear drive and 16 combined in four-wheel drive. It's about time for our turning radius test. Cranked a wide, wide arc. And then you heard the turbo six at full tilt there. Got the clatter of the diesel. But then when cruising, it becomes near silent. And the 10 speed, so smooth at working through the gears. And for a body-on-frame SUV, especially one without air suspension, this ride quality is stellar. Let's see how quick we can get to 60. And to do that, I'm going to make sure that we have the start-stop turned off. I've got my race box set up here, and then we're now in sport drive mode. Brake boost a little, and then off the line. We'll get there eventually. There it is. 8.5 seconds. I shouldn't have to tell you, that's not fast. That's over 2 seconds, like 2.5 seconds slower than the 6.2 liter V8. And therefore, let's keep something in mind with the diesel. Though you get that low end, I would say the 0 to 30 there was quick. 30 to 60, you're like strapped in for a longish ride there. This is not going to set your hair on fire with acceleration. And it's not going to sound as good. Yet again, the soundtrack is not music to anyone's ears. As mid-ranges go, put it in low so I can use these paddles. And the shifts are predictably sluggish. You'll get there. The speeds will build. But particularly on an uphill. They're not going to build that quickly. Look, the Escalade diesel is not a top speed warrior. And it's louder around town. But if you think you're going to use this truck a lot. Hello, 488. Then the fuel economy will be a huge piece. And it may be worth getting this engine to you. I don't think I'd choose it. I think I would stick with the V8. I'd put up with the kind of atrocious fuel economy. For one, really good mid-range. Two, just a great soundtrack. And a soundtrack that I think suits the Escalade much more than diesel clatter. It's the day of Ferraris. It is a supremely comfortable ride. The seats are supportive, there's not quite as much bolstering as I would like, so you do slop in these leather seats over the borders. The suspension, as I said, the dampers do a great job absorbing the road imperfections. There's not a ton of wind noise at speed for a three-row, big boxy luxury SUV. I think we've been in sport this whole time, so I don't really need to change anything as we prepare for a handling test. I'm gonna get up to speed, clamp on the brakes. A lot of nosedive, but it did stop us. And then, oh, we got the traction control system cutting out the power. I'm wondering what's going on, because I'm kind of floored right now. And then it yielded. All right, so at the speeds I was able to do without traction control cutting out power, it's going to give you the confidence that in emergency situations, coming to a full stop is just fine. The pedal is stiff though. So in modulating every day, you're gonna have to use more of your leg strength than you would otherwise expect in a non 6,000 pound SUV. So just be prepared for that if you're coming out of a sedan or a body or a unibody SUV. Now we do have the Super Cruise system, a $2,500 option plus a $25 a month subscription. So let's use that. So we'll activate it here with this button. The green bar means we're good to go. I can take my hands off the wheel and it will stay perfectly in the center of the lane. If I want to change lanes, I can just indicate in that direction. If there is an opening, it will do it. What's great about the system as well is if you set the cruise control to be higher than the speed the vehicle in front of you is allowing, it will look for a lane opening to your left and make the pass of the car that's slowing you down. As long as the route, the highway route, is mapped within Cadillac's cloud server, then Super Cruise is permitted, and I found it works on a lot of highways, most of the highways that I've encountered. Now, if Super Cruise is ever not available, if it didn't have the route mapped, or if it can't find the lane markings, then it will warn you that you need to take over with flashing red lights. And you do need to take over promptly, because if you don't, let's see what we're doing here. Had the opening, changed the lane. See, right there, the flashing red lights. If you don't take over pretty quickly after it flashes the red lights, then it will lock you out of the system. And then you have to wait until you've turned off the vehicle and turn it back on before Super Cruise is available yet again. Here it says it's good to go, so I reactivated it and we're Super Cruising. It's slowing for the curve, not just because we're catching up to a vehicle. And then it's navigating that curve just as well as I would. Okay, maybe I wouldn't have floated over that far into the lane. Super Cruise, what are you doing? The starting figure for the 22 Cadillac Escalade, whether you choose the diesel or the V8, is going to be $77,480. The premium luxury trim, the one we have here, starts at $86,000, and this one, as equipped with Super Cruise and the paint job, is $92,000. Compare that to the crosstown rival, 22 Lincoln Navigator, that starts at about $76,000, makes 440 horsepower, so more even than the V8 version of the Escalade, gets to 60 in a segment quickest 5.2 seconds. Fuel economy, pretty good for that power and that acceleration, at 18 combined. Then there is the Jeep Grand Wagoneer, another American-made three-row SUV. That one starts at $89,000. It does make 471 horsepower, best in the segment. Quick acceleration at 5.4 seconds. Segment leading cargo space at a total of 117 cubic feet. And in my opinion, the nicest interior in this segment. And then finally, if you want to throw in a British unibody, luxury off-road capable SUV, got the 22 Land Rover Range Rover. And I have not driven the latest Range Rover. I have driven the predecessor, and that is an exquisitely comfortable, quiet SUV. Plenty of power, 395 horsepower in the latest version. 0 to 60 in 5.9 seconds would tie the V8 version of the Escalade. Fuel economy of 20 combined MPG is great, and it looks stellar. For my money, not having driven the latest Land Rover, I would choose the Escalade. I wouldn't get the premium luxury. I'd get premium sport with a blacked out grille and the blacked out details. Still got a really nice interior, that 38-inch OLED display. Great ride quality. I would choose the V8. I would give up the diesel's best in segment fuel economy for that soundtrack, for that performance, and for more of that American luxury character. I hope you guys have enjoyed this PV Drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time.